Welcome to the 2 month review, a weekly podcast brought to you by Open Letter and 3%, in which we care much more about Caitlin Clark than we do about audio editing. We are taking a giant book this week, this time Praiseworthy by Alexis Wright, breaking down bit by bit, section by section, week by week, talking about it, having some good times, and analyzing things, I suppose. I don't know. I'm joined as always by Brian Wood, author of Joytime Killbox. I say always, but you're not always here.
Not always. Yeah. I'm about as reliable as, I don't know, internet when you're traveling abroad.
As a swiveling chair sky lady.
And as you might have heard, I'm joined again by Kai Astrominus, who I think is going to sign on for the rest of the season, at least, and probably not read any of the book.
Hey, yeah.
You're in the episode.
I'm catching up. Right now I'm like a quarter of the way through Duck's Newburyport, so I'm getting there.
All right.
Okay. Getting the vibes. That's what I'm doing.
You only have like 14 more seasons to go, I think.
It's good. I'm making good time.
I have to say Duck's Newburyport was one of the best seasons to do because at the end of it we got like a fifth of scotch from the author. So I'm not saying, you know, Alexis Wright should buy us liquor, but I am saying that Alexis Wright should buy us liquor. To be more to the point, New Directions and Other Stories and Jurumundo Publishing should buy us liquor, like all three of them.
I mean, wouldn't you take a fifth of Vegemite instead?
Fuck and no. Absolutely not. Unless I get to put it on steak like my Jane brain does.
I will point out that this is... Sorry, go ahead, Brian.
Oh, no, I was interested. He was talking about that, your guest last week, Emmett, was talking about that sausage and white bread just like rolled up. I am interested. We need to do a culinary colonizers of Australia meal plan one day.
A little kangaroo, a little wallaby, a little crocodile jerky. I would be down for that.
A little donkey.
Oh yeah, donkey meat is tough though. You gotta really smoke that shit.
I wanted to say really, really quick, just to correct me if I'm wrong, but this is what, episode four, five?
Five.
Episode five. Have you guys ever explained the fact that Praiseworthy is the name of the town too?
I mean, it was a given, I suppose.
Is it? Because
I don't know.
Because...
Well, I think that could tie into the conversation today because it becomes representative of like the desire for Aboriginal sovereignty and therefore that being praiseworthy. Like a lot of this book, I think runs off of terrible puns. Honestly, like the fact that Aboriginal sovereignty is the name of a character who then dies, and they're like, we're seeking Aboriginal sovereignty, and that has like ramifications that are beyond the person to like the concept. And that the city is praiseworthy is kind of a bad pun for that. Or like, I don't know if pun's the correct term. I just like that sort of wordplay. That wordplay is like kind of the engine of parts of this. And it's a little on the nose sometimes, but that's not the overall point of the book or the joy of the book. But I think it does drive it. But this, I'm going to start out backwards here. I know we usually banter at the beginning. I want to say that this section, which we read Moth Opera, the entirety of Moth Opera for today,
the section that I was reading.
You read some other fucking shit, like just like a random part of the book. Goes from 265 to 336. It is the third chapter in this book.
Oh, and shit. Okay.
Are you serious?
Yep.
Well done. There's a schedule online.
It's page numbers. I have the ebook. That's not helpful.
Oh, I mean, I'm pretty sure that you could reach me by text if you wanted to, and I would have explained it.
Oh, I'm pretty sure that's not a one-way street.
So Moth Opera is from Oracle 3, Speak Like a Wise Man. And the important part of this is everyone's searching for Aboriginal sovereignty, and then they send in Maximum Superhero Cop God to sort of quell the rebellions in this part of Australia. And so based just on that, we'll get more into it, but based on the fact that it's Maximum Superhero Cop God, and he's recruiting like people for a fake army to fight a fake war and like doing other like cop-like behaviors and losing his shit and his mind. I thought I would ask you guys a new game. I would play a new game. This game is called, unlike last week, which was baseball players or Aboriginal indigenous writers, this week's game is Who's Stronger? simply who's stronger. So I went to a website. Let me find the name of it. It is the Global Firepower Index. And they have the list of the 2024 military strength ratings, which utilizes 60 individual factors to determine a given nation's power index score, with categories ranging from quantity of military units and financial standing to logistical capabilities and geography. Our unique in-house formula allows for smaller, more technologically advanced nations to compete with larger, less developed powers, and special modifiers in the forms of bonuses and penalties are applied to further refine the list, which is compiled annually. So they have a list of all the countries and who and where they rank. So I'm going to ask you, I'm going to give you a country, and you have to tell me if it is stronger than Australia or weaker than Australia. And then I have a tiebreaker that we'll use regardless if you guys tie. Who wants to go first?
And this is based on the proprietary range. Recipe of this website.
Global Firepower Index, man. Motherfucking man. The Global Firepower Index is just indisputably right about their global firepower.
The GFA.
The GFA. GFP.
Do they have like a score of like how?
Oh, they do, actually. Okay, so the number one power index rating is the USA.
I just out of curiosity, how many degrees higher is USA than number two? Because we spend all of our money on, you know, aircraft carriers. So I'm just curious.
Okay, so I'll give you the top three.
What are we getting for our money?
So this is super confusing, but These are the top three because they're not related to the questions. USA has a power index of 0.0699. Nice. Russia has a power index of 0.0702. So just 0.0003 more than the USA, and then China has 0.0706. It's only 0.0007 more than the USA. And then it starts to drop off precipitously after that. Like then it goes to India is next, and they're like 0.1023. So it's like much lower or much higher in the power index, but lower means better. This is something else that I did find, that when they rank military units, zero is ideal. And then anything less than that has a score to it. I don't understand why this works this way. It's like the most backwards way of like looking at things that I can imagine. But there we are. So
because okay, I'm like a 0 to 100 person. So like,
yeah, I know.
If we were like 78, I would hope the next country would be like, you know, 72. Like, oh, I get that. Yeah. That's more. Yeah.
I know.
I'm dumb.
Is it more like the percentage possibility of getting your ass kicked? So if the U.S. is like 0.06,
they got a 6% chance of getting housed.
Possibility of getting our asses handed to us on a plate, and then Russia's next.
Is Godzilla involved? Godzilla Kong New Empire, but Godzilla Kong New Empire is so awesome. That's military firepower. You get Godzilla, he'll truck King Kong right through the pyramids and suplex him. It's like the best sort of defense you could have. Okay, who wants to go first? Australia versus the rest of the world. Who's stronger? Kai, you want to go first?
Sure, I'll go as reigning champion of games right now.
Okay, so this is an easy one. Spain or Australia? Who's stronger?
Spain.
Wrong! Australia is higher than Spain. Spain really? Is four places below Australia on the power index.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, Spain. I mean, come on. You got to think about it for a second. Like, Spain is not, you know, they're not known for like working hard or figuring out paperwork very well. So like, I'm pretty sure their military is shambles. It's probably people standing around trying to figure out how to log into the government website. So I think it's pretty safe to say Spain is like a weak military.
They literally take naps.
They just all the time. They're like flying a plane and taking a nap. I mean, these people are ridiculous. They got to like stop for like their morning beer and like no way.
I heard a great line in a movie last week where this one character, she's like a personal assistant or something. She was, I've literally been trying to take a nap for 2 years. I need you to do this for me right now. Okay. I'm losing it.
That's sort of like that when we walked into the AWP reading at the sports bar, and the person was, of course, reading. Of course, there's a reading at a sports bar during AWP because that's sad. But there are poets, sadder. And one of them was saying, I tried to smoke a bowl, which raises so many questions. Like,
do or do not, there is no try.
Yeah. If you can't figure out how to smoke a bowl, you need to get out of poetry. Okay, Brian, you're up. Indonesia, yes, or Australia? Who's stronger?
Oh, I think Australia houses Indo. Come on.
Nope. Indonesia.
No!
Three spaces higher than Australia.
How dare they? So how dare they?
Okay. We're at 0-0 after one round. Okay. Kaya, here again. The zone's an outlier. Pakistan or Australia? Who's stronger?
You keep giving these like leading yet shitty clues. Pakistan.
Pakistan is stronger. So
nice.
Pakistan is actually seven parts stronger, seven ranks higher than Australia. I think that's due to, doesn't Pakistan have nuclear technology capabilities? Yeah. Yeah. That would make a big difference in terms of military strength. They can nuke Australia. Okay, Brian, Egypt or Australia? Who's stronger?
Well, I mean, like, Egypt lost the war in like 7 days. I mean, come on. It
literally, isn't it seven or six?
they rested on the seventh day. I'm going to go Australia.
No, Egypt is stronger. Egypt is one rank stronger, though. That one's
amazing.
Okay. See, I'm giving Australia way too much credit in case we have an Australian audience for this show.
In case we have an Australian audience and one day they are ranked higher than the U.S.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Don't come first, please.
I believed in you when Egypt was better. Come on. Don't forget me.
So Kaya, who's leading 1-0, who's stronger?
this thrilling game.
For you, yeah.
Who's stronger, Ukraine or Australia?
I mean, if Russia were to invade Australia, would they have a fighting chance the same way? I'm going to say, Slava Ukraini, man. Go Ukraine.
No, Australia is higher. Australia is stronger than Ukraine. And then finally, to try and tie the game and force it to a tiebreaker, Brian, who's stronger, Israel or Australia?
Well, since I was today years old when I learned that Australia does not have nuclear weapons, they probably don't have an Iron Dome either. I don't know when's the last time Australia's killed aid workers. So I'm going to go Israel.
Israel is weaker than Australia.
Oh.
No.
I thought you were going to wait, don't tell me this.
Israel beat Egypt. See, this score means nothing. Come on. This score is nothing.
Israel is also sort of demolishing Palestine right now in a way that like makes you fear for the world.
Come on. Yeah.
Shocking. Right. I was shocked by that one. They're one rank below. They're barely, barely below. Those are super, super close. I picked things that were close to make this a fun game. So, Kai, you're a double time champion. You're up 2-0.
Champion. I got Caitlin Clark by the Iowa new Iowa native, Kaya. Damn it.
Oh, yeah.
The Iowa native.
Iowa native. I could conservatively talk about Caitlin for an hour, but we won't. Tomorrow's game.
What was your tiebreaker?
Okay, here's the tiebreaker. What is the total number of people in the Australian military?
Oh, God.
Whoever gets closer gets the point. I need to do some math here because I know that you guys are going to be way off.
Total personnel?
Yeah. Someone give me a number here.
I'm going to say
30,000.
Okay.
I'm going to say 150,000.
Whoa. Brian, you are much closer. It was 57,346. So 30,000, much closer, slightly higher than
gonna,
that.
But I was going to say that, but you know. But see, that's not helpful because I need like, you know, little. Maybe more like American fun facts. Like, did you know that Canberra is the capital of Australia? Most Americans don't know that. Like, I need that kind of stuff. I don't even know what the population is of Australia.
I don't either. I mean, one of the most interesting things last week, though, was that the fact that, like, it's like 90% of the population lives in, like, Melbourne and Sydney, basically. Like, that I did not realize. And that really did shift my perspective on how remote this book is and how, like, remote these people are and how, like, cut off from the world, from the metropolis world or from that part of the world, which really makes sense for Tommy Hawk's, like, desire to leave, but also his, like, need for an iPad. But anyways, in general,
look at this population map of Australia.
Yeah.
Wow.
So there's Perth, like, Perth is just hanging out there. And then, yeah, just down there.
Is Perth the one in the very middle?
No, they're on the West Coast.
Okay. I can't read the words. Yeah. That's what Emmett was saying, that, like, most of Australia is an enigma to Australians even.
Well, I just looked real quick that according to a 2023 census, it's like 26 point something million people in all of Australia. That's crazy.
So it's like a couple New Yorks.
Yeah, it's just empty. There's a lot of just, yeah. That's
really, you know, for empty. A continent, they're not doing very well population-wise. I mean, they're their own standalone continent, no?
Yeah. Have you seen the fucking spiders?
No, it includes, they just changed the name of it. I'm all confused now. It's not even called Australia anymore. Mick.
Really?
Yeah. See, these are the facts that we need.
Get Emmett on the phone.
Yeah.
Call Emmett up at 4 a.m. Australia time or whatever. Yeah. Like, yo, bro, what's up? Like, yeah, how many, you know, why aren't you guys populating more? Is there like, they're not Catholic. There's no.
Isn't it winter break there anyway right now? Like,
so Kaya, what section of the book did you end up reading?
I ended up reading, so, like, I'm just going to say, I know what happens with Aboriginal sovereignty. Oh, the Kindle's updating. I'm two chapters ahead. So
two chapters ahead.
Yes.
What?
I took a guess. So, I didn't know.
So you have read like Sitting in the Bones?
Yes, not all of it though. Like,
oh my god. Yeah, it's 100 pages long. That was giant. Yeah,
I read like 6 or 7 Kindle pages of it, but
you're from your illegally discovered Kindle version of this book.
Yeah.
Thanks to my class, who does not buy any of the books from my class, but steals them from a website that they told me about, which I'm now exploiting until it goes away.
Oh yeah, but this is great because this book already it's like a couple of the students in my workshop class could definitely benefit from reading this. Like, the things that they're translating have a similar, I mean, when I say similar, I don't mean the same. I don't mean similar, but it has that, like, long sentence structure and all that. So I think that they would like reading it.
Interesting. That's cool. What did you do? Did you like the? So you've read, like, out of context a bit about Aboriginal sovereignty and don't have, like, I mean, I don't know, to be honest, like, from the other sections, even through this one has the most plot or the most, like, most revelations. Like, we get the information that there's a lot of information that's leaked in this chapter. Like, number one, that that Aboriginal sovereignty had a underage girlfriend and that his brother Tommy Hawk narked on him. And that is why he was going to be arrested for being a pedophile. Although he's also underage, he's like 17 and the girl is like 14, 15. So he's like a Wander Franco situation over here. Not to make light of Wander Franco, like his girlfriend's being very young, but nevertheless, like that's what he gets in trouble for. And that's why he goes out to sea and is going to kill himself. There's also, like, obviously a high suicide rate. We get that information. And then we also get sort of the bits about I don't think that this is necessarily a plot point, but like the assimilation idea that the mayor wants to assimilate. They want to assimilate into Australian culture, but yet they also want their Aboriginal sovereignty. So there's this back and forth between, like, desire for true sovereignty, but also to be part of Australia, given, like, the assimilation benefits of, you know, getting support from this mighty military to protect the land. So there's a, like a little bit of that. So there's that background. There's still not a lot of plot. So everything coming up to this, you've got like the entirety of the plot so far, I think, is that Widespread slash Cosman Steel is trying to get donkeys so that there's a form of transportation once all the oil runs out and the fossil fuels are gone. There's a haze sitting over Praiseworthy and over this part of the land. Aboriginal Sovereignty probably kills himself or theoretically kills himself. Tommy Hawk wants to go be adopted by the blonde prime minister, or the not prime minister, the director of Aboriginal Affairs, this blonde white woman in Canberra. And so he's trying to get in touch with her, and he hates his father, who's Cosman Steel. And then the mother, who is Dance, I believe, is like, maybe Mothra. She's maybe Mothra. She controls like all the moths and like they circle around her. So I believe she might be Mothra within the context of my understanding of things. And then there is now the introduction of Maximum Superhero Cop God, who comes to the town to deal with the fact that everyone's like causing they're causing trouble for Canberra and for the government by like demanding Aboriginal Sovereignty be returned and find him and where's the body. There are also like a number of churches, which was also interesting that Emmett mentioned that that's just not a thing in Australia, like religion of that sort. But there's references to a number of churches in the section that are all along a particular road, and they're filled with people praying and singing and chanting for Aboriginal Sovereignty to return. And that's basically the entirety of the plot so far. I don't know, Brian, am I leaving anything out?
No, I think you kind of pretty much nailed it.
Yeah, so the rest of it is just like this circular haze-like, like meandering, like nature. Like when you say the long sentences, it's long sentences, plus they're like sort of redundant in the sense that it doesn't add new information. So it's sentences for the sake of style and for writing rather than sentences to convey a particular new piece of information to the readers. So what'd you like so far, even though you read the wrong section?
The wrong section. Yeah. No, I like, I mean, it's, I think it's quite funny. I think that, I mean, you have to be a very intelligent writer to be able to like take the stereotypes of your culture, your people, and poke fun at it, but also poke fun at it in a way that's, I don't know how to describe it, but I think, I mean, like Emmett was saying last week that she's just, I mean, she's a phenomenal writer, and I can like that. I think that's very, very clear. And I do actually, after him talking last week, I'm also interested in reading her other stuff, having not read anything of her before then. Yeah, I think it's great. I think it was like a lot of nature stuff. So the wrong chapter name drops like all these different like Latinate names for moths and butterflies and things like that. And yeah, it's like very, very of the earth, of the nature. I don't know how else to describe it. I think it's very funny. Like I'm also reading, like I said, Duck's Newbery Report right now. And before that I was reading The Deluge, which is none of those books except the fact that it's very, very long. And the kids in my class have been bringing in like Thomas Bernhardt-esque pieces and also other pieces that are very similarly, so this just kind of feels like the world of literature that I'm in the moment in my life right now, and I'm down with it. I'm here for it.
Yeah, one of the things that he said that when I went back to read this part, because I find the book like interesting and enjoyable in short doses and bursts more so than in like a sustained reading. Like it doesn't have like, I don't care about plot generally in basically anything, except maybe in like mystery novels, but for most books, I don't care about plot at all. I like tone and style and the sort of experimentation of it. So in short bursts, I like this because it doesn't have a compelling pull through for me at this moment in time. I read this section pretty quickly though. Like I got into the first bit of it, and I think the first like 30, 40 pages. And I think part of that was that Emmett had pointed out that like his enjoyment was that you don't know what the next section is going to be, what the next line is going to be, the next paragraph, that it is repetitive, but at the same time, it's like, it just crazy switches from one voice to another, or like from one perspective to another. Like the fact that this is named Moth Opera and mm-hmm. the moths only appear on the last three pages of the section. And they just it's not part of it. Like it's not like a main through line. The main through line is the cop that shows up and like this search for Aboriginal sovereignty. And then the last three pages, they're like, all of a sudden there's these fucking crazy moths and they like form like a dude, like a looking like a man out over the lake, I think. But yeah, the moths are not part of it. So like it's just
moths and butterflies everywhere in two chapters.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Well, the section I read, and that's actually, it's not a sentence, but there's a phrase that she uses. She calls it like a lepidopteran dust. With the butterflies, like when the wind, like when they're migrating back and they basically show back up to where they are and they're like almost in tatters and their wings are almost in tatters on the way back and their migratory patterns. But I just like that phrase, lepidopteran dust, like it.
That's pretty nice.
Like a zoological, biological nerd.
So I'm like, okay, so it's 334 and we read through 336. 334, strange, I'm going to just jump around, but this will tie it all together. Strange miracles continued. Clouds of white butterflies swarmed across the traditional domain. No one had ever seen a butterfly suicide before. Now it seemed as though all the butterflies in the world were dying in the quickness of this procession. Well, the sea looked as though it was covered by fog from the continued massing of whiteness in the dust-hazed skies, with the butterfly migration continuing to arrive from where no one knew. The whole town went down to the beach to see this miracle of a butterfly spirit taking shape on their country. The butterfly spirits were growing into a big story in the world of timeless Aboriginal sovereignty. And as the corpses faded into invisibility, it would be sacrilege to stand on these sacred butterfly spirits that held the story of people's souls drowned by the sea. So the butterflies only, the moths, then referred to as butterflies here, only show up on that last, very, very, very last bit. But it only shows up there, and it does seem to be like two things, like that represents kind of the nature and the impact of like people on nature, and that their deaths and like the stepping on like their spirits. There's constantly like that reference to like the years and the inhabitants and the spirits, which I don't know how to do this as a clean segue, but Brian, you had a really fun YouTube video that you shared that I'm going to put on that'll drop into this podcast that revolves around the idea of like acknowledging that First Nations people were here first, and like now we're like, hey, let's you know, pay attention to this, but the paying attention to it is like very disjointed and a bit like almost facetious in my opinion, but like it's sort of like acknowledge but like not really pay attention to. And I think that both with this section, but also mainly the cop guy, that he comes there and is just like, you know, these people aren't pure. They're not pure enough, like Aboriginal. This is all crazy. They're not doing the right thing. They need to be better at everything. And he goes kind of mad. It reminded me too of the video you sent of Norm Macdonald. So you take it away.
Oh, so it was a bit that Norm Macdonald does. It's some award show. It's a comedy award show or something. And he's supposed to be accepting the award on behalf of somebody. And he stands up and just very seriously says, I'd like to give my time to someone else. And someone comes out wearing the most ridiculous, like head garment with feathers. It goes all the way to the floor. And his name is Johnny Two Feathers. And he just says, I just want you to know, like, where you're sitting right now is just, it's covered in blood. And this whole place, I'd like to laugh with you, but this place reeks of blood. And they're laughing. And so like, you know, don't take offense that I'm not laughing. There's been so much bloodshed and death and terror to my people that you have all displaced that I cannot laugh with you. And they're still laughing the whole time. And then he's like, you know, thank you for this time. And he walks off. And then, you know, Norm Macdonald goes, all right, Johnny Two Feathers. Thank you, Johnny. Let's go on with the show. Like,
Melissa McCarthy is Norm Macdonald.
Thank you. Thank you, but I am sorry I cannot in good conscience accept this award on behalf of Melissa McCarthy. I instead have chosen to give my time to a friend who has something very important to say.
My name is Johnny Two Feathers. While you enjoy tonight's show, I want you to think about something. The spot where you're sitting, every square foot of ground in this country was stolen from my ancestors. And after you stole it, you murdered them. So you'll forgive us if we do not laugh along. There is nothing funny about the extermination of a people. The theater stinks of blood. That's all I have to say. Oh.
Johnny Two Feathers, everybody. Johnny Two Feathers. Give him a wave, Johnny. Johnny, you don't want to wave? All right. Well, Johnny Two Feathers, everybody.
Let's move on, right? Like, this idea of, like, I think it's wonderful to recognize. That's fantastic. It's a great start. But it's like, I was just reading this article about discrimination of women in the workplace. And this researcher, she was like saying like some of the major faux pas and problems in this paper is we are all too confident and happy with the progress we're making. Like, look how great we're doing, like overstating what we're doing to, and it's almost as like, for me, it's like this guilt and this shame of how awful or despicable something is and not wanting to rest in that and not wanting to contain that. And so capping it off and saying, oh, glad I'm doing good. Like, my ancestors displaced the Seneca Nation, which is where my house is right now. Like, shit. Well, glad I got that out of the way. I'm okay now, right? What do we actually do to help things? I just thought that Norm Macdonald bit, it's from 2012, was a wonderful, I mean, obviously it's being humorous, but this book makes me, it's funny, but it makes me so sad at the same time. And it's nice to just kind of sit in that and dwell on it, but then also ask like, geez, what the hell am I actually doing?
Yeah. Yeah. I love that Norm Macdonald bit, cause it reminds me of like a Nathan Fielder sketch where like, it's just straight. Like I hadn't thought of Nathan Fielder in relation to Norm Macdonald until seeing that, but like there is that bit of their quote unquote comedy where it's just like social realism. Like, it's like, here is the thing. Now, how do you react to it? And if people are laughing at it, he doesn't play it for a joke at all. Like maybe he is conceptually, but in the presentation of it, he literally, like you said, stands behind him. And the guy says like the direct truth, and everyone's like, oh, okay. Like, we're not going to do anything about that. Instead we're just going to think this is funny. Like a Andy Kaufman.
Bit. Andy Kaufman. Yeah. And the whole joke was the entire joke is Norm Macdonald standing behind him with his hands folded, doing this like serious look of this is really important. Right. That is the actual joke, right? Hey, we're doing this conversation. Let's check this box here that we recognize, you know, I want to give my time. It's this like Hollywood talking about, you know, global warming and the impact of, and like they all live in, you know, 80,000 square foot homes in Malibu. And it's like, okay, thank you for taking your platform to, you know, stand on this and it's all false and fake and get out of here.
Isn't that kind of Tommy Hawk's role in a possibly reverse way? Like isn't that kind of what his role is, do you guys think? Like, if he's like walking around being like, I mean, I don't know if it's a spoiler, but two chapters ahead, he has an iPhone.
He has an iPhone.
Okay, but like he's like always carrying the iPhone around and like always has it, and everybody around him is like, oh, like, you know, like look at that flashy flash. Like
in this chapter, he has to sneak into someone's house to charge it because
this is 296.
Yeah. Yeah, page numbers don't mean anything.
Oh, sorry.
If you had page numbers, it wouldn't match up, to be honest.
This is one of my favorite lines of the week, actually. And I think it's perfect to what you're saying, where it's like this clash of modernity. Yeah, like this clash of modernity mm-hmm. And where you fit in. And it's a wonderful, like, sad but really funny line. It's one of those long lines, but it's like whip smart. Love it. On my version, it's on page 296, right in the middle. The iPhone was taking an eternity to charge on the slow use electricity suppliers, low voltage pay as you use card, paid by pension money and slotted into the meter box for all the family to use until it cashed out. And he prayed for the federal government's golden haired guardian angel, the Saint Mother Holy Minister in charge of all Aboriginal children, to hover above him in this moment of great peril and to prevent him from being caught by marauding black people.
And then I have the next line underlined as well. And all the while he cursed her because his stupid parents refused to live in the 21st century and had cut the power off to their house so he could not use any of their precious electricity. But like, that is both funny. And like, that was one of the ones I was thinking of in terms of like the initial conception of this is that, you know, it's my initial conception was that Praiseworthy is like an Aboriginal city, but is a city. And like the fact that they have to pay for electricity using like a card as a pay as you go sort of situation is like really reduces that into something that's much more like tenuous, and like the government's influence is so much more prominent, and the sort of like level of quality of life is different than what I was initially like picturing in my mind.
Well, I love the way like that these two brothers, like when you think about the juxtaposition of them, where like one's going to walk into the ocean and the other's moment of great peril is, can I get my iPhone charged?
Yep. Mm-hmm. YouTube banter, I have to take the kid to the bathroom.
Okay. Yeah. I wanted to try to explain my reasoning. Cause I don't know if it's clear. Like when I said that after you explained the Norm Macdonald joke, and the relation of Tommy Hawk to that, I think, I feel impelled to clarify. I feel it's like the inverse, like everyone else in Praiseworthy is like, yeah, we're an Aboriginal town. We do our like old timey, ancient ghost spirit stuff and like follow our traditions because this is our land. And he's like, yeah, but like just down the road, there's like shiny government office with all the electricity you could ever want, and like let's like, yeah, it's like I don't know, I'm just drawing connections, maybe I'm completely fucking off, but because I am also I did also read two chapters.
you're living in the future.
I am. For once I'm so on schedule. This is something I try to think of in terms of the workshop class I'm teaching, but have you read anything else like this?
Like this as far as like the way it's, like the actual style, the way it's written?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah.
I think it's really cool. I guess like it maybe seems a little bit unfair, but I get a lot of like vibes thinking about Ducks Newberry Port when I'm reading this. I guess, you know, not for like the obvious things of like the size of it, but obviously it's some of the longer sentences trying to like, it's the idea of like, for me, it was like this idea of in Ducks Newberry Port with like the environment being in peril. And that kind of like circling in on a character and causing like all this discomfort for a character and the world they live in. And then with this one, thinking about like starting off, there was so much environmental impact, like globally, that it's talking about. And then we're getting like, as it's coming in, we're getting more of like the community impact, the like family impact. And it's kind of like circling in and in and in, like kind of crushing these two kids. So I see some like similarities there, and then there's like that force of the way the prose is actually written that goes really well with it. Like it has a sense of aimlessness but urgency at the same time, mm-hmm. which feels like really good with what the material is.
Yeah.
As far as like if I put my little writer hat on and trying to think about it, but
yeah, I mean, this also, like, the, you keep talking about the nature and like all the things Emmett said, like this, I don't usually think of books in terms of like, oh, this could be a course book for a class or something, but this, I mean, this could be just, you know, white person ignorance, but this seems like in general, it could be a very good book for all things just like Australia. Like depending on how factual some of these things, I'm just thinking about the moths and stuff like that, but just the wildlife, like it's really very detailed.
I am kind of curious how the Australian like curriculum is as far as when they deal with First Nation and how they explore that. Cause I know like maybe it's changed cause we're getting old, but I know for me, it was basically like you would get Housemaid of Dawn and maybe Ceremony. You would read those books maybe to discuss Indians in the United States. Maybe it's changed now. I don't know, but.
Well, I don't know either of those books, unfortunately.
You know, a Ceremony? That's surprising.
Is it though?
background? That's because you grew up in Iowa. You're too busy eating corn and worshiping Caitlin Clark.
But like
again, I worship Caitlin Clark. So,
and again, did not grow up in Iowa.
Oh yeah, that's right.
But you know, but it's very similar to the, if we go back to like Johnny Two Feathers, like boy. We've got a really serious history of like blood, death, torture, displacement, genocide. Mm-hmm. Let's do 200 pages in a novel and we'll call that a day. Let's keep moving. Yeah. Nothing to see here. Moving on, right? Like
again, not to beat the dead horse, but that is like the curse too, where they have like, they're like, we have indigenous art in our houses that we're building here for mm-hmm. you to buy at an exorbitant price. Isn't this wonderful? Here's this art. And everyone's like, ew. It's like super cringy and it's played so straight by Emma Stone. It's like wonderful. Like that it does make you think. And that kind of is the
point. We could tie it in perfect because she gets mad that he's holding an iPhone with, with the property. So there you go. You have the iPhone next to the indigenous art. There you go.
I mean, that's one of the key points. That and he wants to get cocked. So like this is, we get cock material via the curse for the
and Bandit. And we can bring in Bandit perfectly. Yeah.
Poor Bandit. Well, I don't know. I mean, people are into that. So, like,
I think Kai's got a great point, though, because this, for me, this has been a wonderful kind of like introduction into like one, exposing as if I needed illuminated. Like, wow, I've got a lot of blind spots and I have a lot of like gaps in what I need to know and understand if I'm going to interact with the world in any kind of meaningful way. Mm-hmm. And so it's been so humbling to read this and realize I don't know anything. Wow. And so like, all the different like threads and way, like you start pulling on a thread and what do you want like uncover and discover. It's been really fascinating to, I mean, you only have to go back about 70,000 years to get a start of, you know, how this begins. The first civilization basically on Earth. Yeah. Cool. That have been in the same place longer than any other people on the planet Earth. Ooh, okay. And then you start thinking about displacement and taking that away just recently. And what does that actually mean? What kind of pain is like, that's undescribable and unknowable for really any other culture. It's like, mm-hmm. Can we be done with this episode so I can say I did it and I can move on and not have to think about that ever again and feel good about myself and go have a latte?
We get it. There's blood. It's everywhere.
Johnny Two Feathers, everyone. Johnny Two Feathers.
Man, I want to like not to, well, to add on to what you're saying. One thing is like, I do appreciate that this is very different from most of the other books in certain ways, that the writing is sort of at times befuddling or like a bit like hard, not hard to get through, but a little bit hard to pay attention to in certain ways. And I think that that's a feature in the sense that it is telling things different. There's like this, what's his last name? There's a African writer, I forget which country he's from, that wrote a book called The United States of Africa. And it's very interesting both for its content, but basically because it's always, it's kind of inverted. Like it is, it does presume that Africa is like the center of like technology and like, and culture, but the way that it's written is so like daunting in a sense, because it's not American. Like it's truly inverted in terms of how the focus works, the sentences works. It's interesting. But you mentioned Kaya, the deluge, and that too, in terms of like books about climate change, like this book does involve the haze, the climate's invoked, like you were saying, Brian, it's like part of the, like kind of baked in, and it's not pedantic. And the deluge, which I do love as a book, and I think is really fun to listen to and fun to read, and is supposed to be like a big climate change book. And it does address that from start to finish, but it's so much more like, here are the things you should know. Here's what's going on. Here's what's going to happen in the future when, like, you know, it's hard to get food across the country due to like flooding and all these various like catastrophic like weather occurrences and like the fights that will happen between like politicians and protesters and how effective can you be? And it's very like bang, 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 like here it is. And that's a very American style of like, this is it. And this book doesn't do that. It like sort of dwells in the like, this is happening. Now I'm going to get some donkeys. You know, I want to escape. Like it doesn't have that, like, you need to pay attention to this. Here's the answer. Here's the thing that's happening, you know, but it does, it has that, or it has an urgency that's not being so articulated.
It's more of a seeping than a hammering in of information.
I don't know if seeping is a good word to use, but that's, yeah.
I think it's a great
word. Be careful.
But even though, the other thing too, that I just want to bring up is like, I do so much appreciate like Emmett showing up, and it kind of makes me think like that idea of recognizing this, the people and the stories that have come before you and like, what are you standing on? Mm-hmm. Cause I start thinking about like, you know, Canada, them, us, these like post-colonial countries that are like, the foundation is all like very similar. And so then there's this kind of idea of like the literature in these places where there's, you know, for lack of better terms, like there's the white literature and then there's indigenous literature. Yeah. And yeah, how those stories are told, how do we interact with them? How do we share them? How, like, I think that's really interesting that we can all share that same, like that same similar history, that same like violence. And what do we do with it now? I think it's really cool. Not that that's really cool. I think it's really cool that we share that experience and we're navigating the same waters and we're doing it in different ways and we're failing in different ways and we're, you know, making progress in different ways. But I think it's really interesting. It just, I'm glad he started last podcast that way, because it was really a great reminder for me as we're reading this book. So just wanted to thank him for that. That was really cool.
Yeah, Emmett was really helpful on all this. I also, for anyone listening that's not that does not subscribe to Between the Covers, David Naiman's podcast that comes out through Tin House, he interviewed Alexis Wright for this week's episode. I listened to most of it, maybe half of it. And like a lot of it was, there wasn't a lot to like bring from the part that I listened to bring over to this podcast. But one thing that she did reference was that her book, her nonfiction book Tracker, that won the Stella Prize, the Queensland Literary Award, and the Magarey Medal, and is a nonfiction book about Tracker Tilmouth. That Tracker Tilmouth was part of the inspiration for Cosman Steele. And Tracker, here's just the Wikipedia bio. And I don't know if she's like playing with this, because this isn't going to sound like Cosman Steele, at least not the one that we've met so far. I don't know if she's playing with this idea or what's going on, but Tilmouth was a Arrente man who was born in the Alice Springs region, a Northern Territory Aboriginal activist. He was part of the Stolen Generation, being taken from his family at the age of 3 to Retta Dixon home in Darwin and later raised on Croker Island. Then he helped like establish the Central Australian Aboriginal Legal Aid Service and the Aboriginal Health Service in the south of the Northern Territory, served as a director for the Central Land Council, and he was a lifetime member of the Australian Labor Party and was running to be the party senator for the Northern Territory. He died in 2015. The like how that relates exactly, I'm not certain yet. I don't know if that will change as we go along, but like there is something about the like wanting to establish something. And Cosman still does want to do something for the territory. He's created a pyramid scheme out of it, but he does want to like be like, hey, yo, this is how we're going to create, this is how we're going to have money. This is how we're going to have our sovereignty, is because we will control all transportation via donkeys, because donkeys are feral and they're everywhere. But oil and gas and all that kind of shit is ruining our world. We can't, that's going to not be used anymore, but people can always use these donkeys. So we'll all be rich and this will be our money making. So he's trying to help out, but she's sort of playing with that idea. But the fact that that tracker was taken from his home at the age of 3, that's part of the thing that Emmett alluded to. And the book has baked into it too, in terms of Aboriginal sovereignty. They're going to come take him away. He's older, but like, this is a real thing where there's like, these people can't raise their kids. They're not capable. They're not okay. We're going to take their kids from them and raise them ourselves, so they're better assimilated, so on and so forth. And that's like horrifying. And is like such a, I mean, that'd be fundamentally like the most terrifying way to live as a parent. Like, I'm can't do anything right. Like, and raising a kid is like, you know, you just like, if anyone watches you closely, you're just screwing up all the time. I feel like, if anyone is just like, I'm going to totally judge you, your kid has the kids watching the phone right now. Like, that's not okay. Like, I took him to see Godzilla, Kong, New Empire at age 6. I don't know if that's a good thing. It's a PG-13 movie. There's like, you know, there's a lot of violence. There's so much good violence. It's so good. I can't emphasize enough how much fun Godzilla Kong is. But like that, then the idea that your kids are just be taken away, but then also they're raised not with this Aboriginal tradition. Like, that's erased from them. So like the lost generation sort of aspect of it isn't by choice. It's by like, it being like taken out of you. And that I think too has happened in Canada. And there's been lots of reports of that recently related to things that happened some years ago, but are being like discussed and talked about now, and definitely would have happened within Native Americans as well. But like, it is something that like also like resonates in this book and has like a super importance, but she doesn't like overemphasize that there's the pedophiles and the government is like concerned and all this stuff, but it's not overemphasized as to like, how harrowing would that be? Like, if that were your normal state of being, that the government just might show up and take away kids from your community, that's a really crazy way to live.
Just like CPS is always on the prowl. CPS. And they can do whatever they want. Like, yep. Arbitrarily, like, that's too much candy at Halloween, your kid's coming with us.
Yeah. You drink too much, kid's coming with us. Like, that's, you watch pornography, kid's coming with us. Like, under the rules that they have for this, it's like, I don't know if there's like specific like levels or ways that they grade it, but like the things that they're banned for this reason, and under the belief that everyone's a pedophile and that they're incapable of raising their kids, are like no porn and no booze. And like, that's like crazy. Like, when our Instagram economy runs off of like people making jokes about how they're like iffy parenting skills, and like they drink too much, and they like have tricks so that they can get away from their kids. Like, that's sort of like the joke economy of Instagram. And in Australia, that's like, they're instead like, the way that they want the Indigenous people to live, or Aboriginal people to live, is like the Bluey model. And the Bluey model is fucked. That's part of the reason I think Bluey is a terrible show, is that it's not realistic in a way that's like actually bullshit. It's like, it's like religion. Fuck Bluey is my final statement on that. Coming in hot. So I have to get to class. So do you guys have a favorite line from a section we have not read?
Yeah, well, I told you the phrase that I really liked was Lepidopteran dust, where she's describing the general disintegration of all these moths and butterflies, and just like their dust in the wind, but Lepidopteran dust. I like it.
Daddy? I love that line. Shh, Alex, wait. There was a section I wanted to read out loud, but it would be too long now to talk about. Where is it though? I had it here. Oh, this part that talks about that everyone would be able to see that the murder of Aboriginal sovereignty, and he's kept cranking the philosophical opera his mind was staging, with Aboriginal sovereignty enjoying his role as the dead director who was out for revenge to get the fat little brother as a murderer for killing him slowly, to drive him to his own death with a gangbuster cast of totally unsophisticated and unskilled actors without any inkling of clicking castanets between them to create a bit of excitement, while for endless hours they stumbled around the stage with boring continuous monologues spoken to each other that when you thought they would never stop, they would stop, never ended, and he could barely manage to shut out the dullness, the extreme tedium of having Aboriginal sovereignty boring him out of his mind any further. So this is a part that I really liked for like Tommy Hawk and for the relationship to like this. Now that Aboriginal sovereignty is gone, this is equally nonsense. And like, these people are horrible. He hates being there. That sort of like disdain for it all, I really liked. But Brian, did you have another line of the week? Or
I'll play off yours. What if Absaw was not dead? What if he was just half dead? What do you reckon happened to your brother, eh?
I like that. The other one that I marked here as line of the week is there's a quote on 286 where it's like, the boy punched the awesomeness of this big government of Australia dream world into the air. You are the best you, government. Go, you, white people.
I saw that one.
Yeah,
the non-funny part really quick, the part that you read, Chad, I wanted to point out also that it's so eloquent, it's so simple, but it's so eloquent, and I think that's what, just like cold reading a random chapter, had drawn me to Alexis Wright as an author.
I'll end by pointing out that Miss McIntosh, My Darling, is now available from Delkey Archive with its thick. It's 1,300 and whatever pages it is, 1,321. The printing is screwy because they have like they screwed up your design. No surprise there, but I do want to point out to anyone who's listening, and I'm sure everyone listens to the end of this podcast, that this book has only been made possible thanks to Kaya's work of designing it, laying it out, and being able to find a format in which it was printable as one volume rather than two volumes before, because this is not standard. 1,300 page book on acid free paper. This is like unusual to the extreme, and it makes me sad that they fucked the last page up. But such is life.
Yep, I did not send it to the printer, so that was not.
No, it shouldn't have. This should not never have happened. There's actually a blank page beforehand too, which is unnecessary. But like, yeah, whatever. They did. They do the best they can.
They try real hard. Someone didn't proof the proof.
They sent it to us 14 times. Nobody went to the last page. Also, a book that I believe zero people that work at this press have read more than 20 pages of. There's that. Anyways, anyone want to plug anything else or have anything to say? Go Iowa tomorrow on Friday, April 5th.
Go Iowa.
I hate UConn, and I hope that they demolish UConn. I hate UConn in all sports, and I would like to see Caitlin Clark win it all.
That'd be great.
And also, I mean, worth noting, the game on Monday between LSU and Iowa is the most watched sporting event. It was the third most watched sporting event of the past year, more than every NBA game, more than everything but the Super Bowl, like more than every Major League Baseball game. Like, the viewership numbers are off the charts, which I just want to point out is pretty cool. It's sort of what you said, Brian, about like women in the workplace. Like, that is a positive. This is a positive thing. Like, they have to build off of. So
wait, we can go in the workplace?
No. Oh.